won the battle for you, and he has turned every altar, he has taken the power out of every altar, and what you and I have to do is to appropriate it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Glory to God. There is power in the name of Jesus. You see, many of these Asian and African films that are shown on television, and I know that there are people who love these kinds of films. When you see those altars and you see people going to venerate those shrines, don't just take it for granted that they are doing it for doing sake. Of course, in a film, it's an imagery. But what they are doing is that they are doing what is real. Is somebody with me? And you and I must not be ignorant. But the glory is that the power belongs to us in the name of Jesus. You see, the altar is a place of worship. When we talk about altar, it's a place of worship. It's a place of thanksgiving and sacrifice. It is a place of covenant. It is a place of contact. In other words, it is a spiritual highway for angelic or demonic spirits. Are you hearing me? The truth about altars is that what happens on the altar determines the destinies of individuals, the very individual who is venerating that altar. It determines the destiny of cities, nations, and families. In Genesis chapter 8, let's go back to Noah. Genesis chapter 8. Noah built an altar after the flood. And I want us to look at another thing in that chapter again. The Bible says in verse 20 of Noah chapter, Genesis chapter 8, the Bible says, then Noah built an altar to the Lord. Genesis chapter 8, verse 20. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a soothing aroma. Then the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground for man's sake, although the imaginations of man's heart is evil from his youth, nor will I again destroy every living thing as I have done. Then God made that powerful declaration. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, and winter and summer, day and night shall not cease. Then in chapter 9, jump down to verse 11. Let's start from verse 9. Then God spoke to Noah and to his sons with him, saying, verse 9, as for me, behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you. Understand that what happens on an altar, and this is God speaking to Noah because of the altar he erected and the sacrifice he made on that altar. Then God speaks again and says, verse 9, as for me, behold, I establish my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the cattle, and every beast of the earth with you, of all that you go out of the ark, every beast of the earth. Then God begins to explain the covenant. Thus I establish my covenant with you. Never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant which I make between me and you, and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generation. I set my rainbow in the cloud, and it shall be for the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. It shall be, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that a rainbow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you, and every living creature of the flesh. The waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. the rainbow shall be in the cloud. And I will look on it to remember the everlasting covenant. A what covenant? Between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. Powerful revelation. God says, Noah, because of this altar that you have erected unto me, this godly altar, and the sacrifice that you have made on the altar, I will no longer use rain or flood to destroy the earth. And this is the seal of that covenant. The seal is that I will cause a rainbow to appear in the sky. And anytime it rains or anytime it's cloudy and you see that rainbow, it shall be a sign, an everlasting covenant between me and my creation and anything that lives, that I will no longer destroy the world with water. How many of you have ever seen a rainbow? Glory to God. And this is how the rainbow was put in the skies. So understand that what happens on the altar determines the destinies, not only of the individuals and families, but also cities and nations. I pray that tonight the Lord will lead you to establish a new covenant with him. And the covenant that he will establish with you on the altar that you will build will be a permanent and an everlasting covenant between you, God, and your family in the name of Jesus. Amen. Understand that all what the devil does is to duplicate what is real, as I said last Sunday. In the Old Testament, when people sinned, what they did was that they went into the temple of God. They held to the horns of the altar. In other words, they came and they fell prostrate before the altar. And as long as they were on a godly altar, no man was meant to touch them. The truth about life is that the enemy has duplicated godly altars. And so many evil altars have been erected, and too many people are struggling just because of the evil altars. Tonight, you'll be set loose in the name of Jesus. Tonight, your family shall walk away free in the name of Jesus. The Bible records for us an interesting story about altars in the book of Numbers, chapter 22. Balak and Balaam. Anytime you hear the word Balak and Balaam, for you to remember, the K is a king, then the M is a false minister. And Balak was afraid because the children of Israel had been set liberty from Egypt and they were on the march through into the promised land. And their fear fell on them because the angel of the Lord was going ahead of them. Look at verse 2 of Numbers 22. Now Balak the son of Zippor saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites, and Moab was exceedingly afraid of the people because they were many, and Moab was sick with dread because of the children of Israel. May your fear fall on your enemies because of the glory of the Lord over your life in the name of Jesus. And understand that one of the major reasons why the enemy will always try to erect an altar to fight against you is because of the glory of the Lord that is over your life. Verse 4. So Moab said to the elders of Midian, "Now, this company will lick up all that is around us as an ox licks up the grass of the field." Fear. And Balak, the son of Zippor, was king of the Moabites at that time. Then he sent messengers to Balaam, the son of Beor. And Balaam was a prophet, but probably a false prophet, which is near the river of the land of the sons of his people, to call him, saying, "Look, a people has come from Egypt. See, they cover the face of the earth and are settling next to me. Therefore, please, come at once, curse these people for me, for they are too mighty for me. Perhaps I shall be able to defeat them and drive them out of the land, for I know that he whom you bless is blessed, and he whom you curse is what? Is cursed." So the elders of Moab and the elders of Midian departed with what? The diviner's fee in their hand. And they came to Balaam and spoke to him the words of Balak. Wow. So here at Trinity Baptist Church, marching into the promised land. And our fear fall on the cities, the jobs where you are working, the families out of which you have come from. Your fear fall on the people. And because of that, they know that you are blessed. So what do? They make a determination to consult a prophet. And this prophet that they went to consult takes money. A diviner's money. So your enemies send emissaries or people to this oracle or this altar that he might pronounce a curse. So understand, and Balak's aim was to fight Israel. But before the fight, he wanted a curse to be imposed on them. Because Balak understood that battles are fought and won in the realm of the spirit and not physically. So his plan was, go see the prophet, the false prophet, pay him money, and let him pronounce a curse over the people. The rest will be just a formality. Then come to 23. Look at what happened. Then Balaam said to Balak, this is after he had come. The donkey had spoken to him on the way because at a point God didn't want him to come, but he became stubborn. His donkey spoke to him. Then Balaam said to Balak, chapter 23, verse 1, build 7 what? Altars for me here. And prepare for me here 7 bulls and 7 rams. And Balak did just as Balaam had spoken. And Balak and Balaam offered a bull and a ram on each altar. Then Balaam said to Balak, stand by your burnt offering. Oh. And I will go, perhaps the Lord will come to meet me. And whatever he shows me, I will tell you. So he went to a desolate height. And God met Balaam and he said to him, I have prepared the 7 altars. And I have offered on each altar a bull and a ram. Then the Lord put a word in Balaam's mouth and said, may the Lord put a word in the mouth of the false prophets in the name of Jesus. Amen. Even when they want to pronounce a curse, may the Lord turn it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Then the Lord put a word in Balaam's mouth and said, return to Balak, and thus you shall speak. So he returned to him, and there he was standing by his burnt offering. In other words, standing by the altar. And there are people, they take all kinds of things to these false altars. And they wait till things happen. But tonight, you are walking away free in the name of Jesus. Verse 7. And he took up his oracle and said, Balak, the king of Moab, has brought me from Aram, from the mountains of the east. Come, curse Jacob for me, and come, denounce Israel. How shall I curse whom God has not cursed? And how shall I denounce whom the Lord has not denounced? For from the top of the rock I see him, and from the hills I behold him. There, a people dwelling alone, not reckoning itself among the nations. Who can count the dust of Jacob or number 1/4 of Israel? Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my end be like this. Ha! This is a man that has been paid to curse, but God met him and put his word in his mouth. And when he went to the guy standing by the altar, he could not pronounce the curse, but to declare what God has said. From tonight, in the name of Jesus, those that have sat down and have gathered and are planning your fall, may God put his words in their mouth in the name of Jesus. You see, what we see here is that God himself understood the power of the altar. And as such, will not allow Balak to make any pronunciation on the altar. Instead, he puts his word in his mouth. Because God knows that in the realm of the spirit, when a prophet, be him good or evil, if that person pronounces a curse on an altar, it will come to pass. But you see, Balak was not the kind that would give up. So, he takes Balaam to another place. Look at 23:19-26. Let's start from 18. Then he took up his oracle and said, let me start from 17. So he came to him, and there he was standing by his burnt offering. And the princes of Moab were with him. And Balak said to him, what has the Lord spoken? Then he took up his oracle and said, rise up, Balak, and hear. Listen to me, son of Zippor. God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should repent. Has he said, and will he not do it? And tonight, the Lord will work a miracle for you in the name of Jesus. And you know, we all love quoting this scripture, that God is not a man that he should lie. But at times, we fail to understand the background of this saying. The background of this scripture was that Balak had wanted to curse the children of Israel, but God will not take it. So from tonight, the Lord will not allow any altar to stand up against you in the name of Jesus. But you know what? But God has to put his word in the mouth of the person that operates that altar. And that is the secret. Because if God had not done that, and Balaam had pronounced that curse on Israel, Israel would have been in trouble. So God had to intervene. Tonight, may the Lord intervene on your behalf. I said, may the Lord intervene on your behalf in the name of Jesus. A true story that I shared with you that last Sunday. A man that was so deep into the occultic world and was very good in the operating of altars, killing innocent people, rendering people's destinies void. So this young man got converted, and the Lord so blessed him. So and a jealous, and at times people just take you to altar simply because they are jealous of you. Because they can't stand your promotion. That is why at times people are promoted in a place, and all of a sudden the one that was promoted is unable to go to work again. A true story that happened in a parliament in Africa. True story. This one, not story. True story. On the seat and on the table of the head of the opposition leader, they put this idol. And how they managed to unscrew the chair and put that thing in, only heavens know. But the good news was that the night before that country's parliament was to open, well, the session was to come on, for the president to address and for parliament to be declared open, they had gone for an all night. And God had spoken through his servant to the head of the opposition party. So when the guy sat on his table, all of a sudden he began to feel uneasy. Right in the middle of parliament. He said, what is this? So he insisted, and the man of God had shown him what was on the chair he was going to sit on. This is government. Government. 2014. No, this was 2012. So he insisted. They brought carpenters. They opened the chair up. Come and see Dufa. Right in the middle of parliament. You see, you don't read the news. And the essence of that was to weaken him, to paralyze him, and to make him become a yo-yo man. And today there are so many people, at times you wonder whether something has twisted their minds. Tonight is a night of liberty in the name of Jesus. Amen. All times. They are real, but so is the power of God. Hallelujah. Verse 20. Behold, I have received a commission to bless. He has blessed and I cannot reverse it. Tell your neighbor, I am blessed and the enemy cannot reverse it. Glory to God. But you see, the issue about altars is that you don't just sit down and then you just, I'm born again, I'm on fire. You have to pronounce and reverse these things in the name of Jesus. If God himself had to send, put his words in the mouth of a false prophet to speak his own word instead of a curse, then you and I have to take altars seriously. But the good news is that there is power in the name of Jesus. Verse 21. He has not observed iniquity in Jacob, nor has he seen wickedness in Israel. The Lord his God is with him, and the shout of a king is among him. God brings them out of Egypt. He has strength like a wild ox. For there is no sorcery against Jacob. Tell your neighbor, there is no sorcery against me. You see, and if God had not intervened, the sorcery would have worked against Israel. But God had to intervene and put his word in the mouth of this false prophet. For there is no sorcery against Jacob, nor is there divination against Israel. So it means that no matter how they sit down and they chant, no matter what, how they sit down and try to operate against you, if you stand on the authority of God's word, on the power in the covenant of the blood of Jesus, and by the resurrection power, and reverse the operations of these altars, you shall walk away free in the name of Jesus. Nor is there any divination against Israel. It now must be said of Jacob and of Israel, oh, see what the Lord has done. Tell your neighbor, see what the Lord is doing in my life. Look, a people rises like a lioness and lifts itself up like a lion. It shall not lie down until it devours the prey and drinks the blood of the slain. And then Balak said to Balaam, neither curse them at all, nor bless them at all. Now he has discovered that he can't win. Hallelujah. Then jump with me to chapter 31 and verse 16. Very powerful incident. And while all this was going on, God was watching. 31 and verse 16. The Bible says, look, this woman caused the children of Israel through the counsel of who? Through who? To transpass against the Lord in the incident of Belpoa, and there was a plague among the congregation of the Lord. Now, jump to chapter 25. Keep your finger there. We'll come back. Understand that Balaam was bribed to curse the children of Israel, and that altar and the sacrifices on it could not work because God put his word in the mouth of Balaam and Balaam could not curse them. Then look at verse 25. Then Israel, pardon me, 25, chapter 25. From verse 1. Then Israel remained in Achaia Grove, and the people began to commit what? Harlotry with the women of Moab. Children of Israel, They invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods, and the people ate and bowed down to their gods. So Israel was joined to Baal of Peor, and the anger of the Lord was aroused against Israel. Then the Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of the people and hang the offenders before the Lord out in the sun, that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away. Then jump to verse 9. The Bible says, and those who died in the plague were how many? Listen to the story carefully. Here is Balak. He sees a people who are blessed. So he calls for a false prophet to curse them. But God puts his word in the mouth of this false prophet, who had prepared an altar and had sacrificed bulls. And all that he had to do after that was to speak. You see, an altar is useless till words are spoken. So normally, when people go to the altars, they tell you, go and bring what? Go and bring a green sheep. Go and bring white, whatever, calico, and all kinds of things. Go and bring them. So when you bring them, then they take it to that altar, then they begin to chant. So here, Balak took those things, the bull, the altar, seven altars. That was how serious he had wanted to punish Israel. But through them all, God intervened. Then he discovered that these were a people who were blessed. There was nothing that he could do against them, because to pronounce a curse will not work. So he gave counsel to Balak and the people of the Midianites and the Moabs that the only thing that you can get these people and destroy them is to turn them against their God, is to make them sin against God. And the moment they sin against God, God himself will punish them. Are you getting the picture? So what Balaam is saying, look, this altar will not work. But the only way you can get the children of Israel is to teach them to sin. And two things that when they do, God will be angry. One, let the Moabite women entice them. And this is counsel that was given by Balaam. So he advised the people of Moab and Balak, so they sent their beautiful women among, and the children of Israel started sleeping with them. And not only that, they also took them to their own altars, the Baal, and they started bowing to them. And the anger of the Lord was aroused against them. God, who out of the abundance of his mercy was protecting them. You see, one thing that God will never accept is idolatry. If there is anything that God hates, it's idolatry. And if there is anything that is killing and destroying the third world nations of the earth, it is idolatry. Today, you will see people who come to church, at the same time, they'll go and consult oracles. Today, you will see people who will tell you how serious they can pronounce every slogan in the Bible. But deep in their hearts, they are wearing all kinds of rings and all kinds of things around their waist and all over their bodies. And those things, God hates it. And in one day, the anger, God caused a plague, and 24,000 children of Israel died till Moses intervened. So understand that as a people of God, when it comes to altars, and at times the truth is that we are deceived and enticed by people to go to these altars. They tell you, oh, I know somebody who, you remember last Sunday, the message I was preaching, a church was called Jesus Sharp Sharp. Jesus Sharp Sharp. That is the name of a church. So they tell you, let's go. And these are people who promise every kind of, oh, wow. Jesus Sharp Sharp Church. Come on, let me go on. Let's look at the effects of altars, then we start praying. What are the effects of these altars? They oppose God and His grace in people's life. You see, when these altars start to operate against people, the effects are that what everybody gets easily becomes a struggle for the others. And at times, you see that there are people, they are even believers. But things that others will do and get easily, it becomes a struggle for them. Tonight is your night of victory in the name of Jesus. Whatever altar is speaking against you, wherever you yourself stepped as a child of God, wherever anybody enticed you, whoever, because out of jealousy, hatred, and envy is venerating oracles and altars against you tonight, you will receive your liberty in the name of Jesus. They oppose what God wants to do in your life and the grace of God. They sit down, and some of them promise they will never give themselves sleep till they cause somebody to fall. The second thing they do is that they result in endless struggles and sufferings. Endless struggles. And you see that some people, they have one struggle. Of course, life is a test. But for some, it is unusual. One struggle after another struggle. 500 of you will take your papers to the home office. 499 will come. You wrote the same application the same day. Yours becomes a struggle. Tonight, that altar is falling in the name of Jesus. You see, there is power in the blood of Jesus. And there is power in the spoken word. Once these things are discovered and the right words are spoken, they lose its power in Jesus' name. They result in endless struggles and sufferings. And normally this is because of family altars. You see, what some of these family altars do is that they monitor the progress of innocent people. And when you are converted, understand that the blood of Jesus covers you, but there are some confessions you must make. And don't just take your children to these people. You see, you go to wherever you come from, and you've come. Your children are shining with the glory of the Lord. God has covered them nicely. And you just take them, oh, this is my daughter, and this is my son, and this is my daughter. He just finished sixth form. She'll be going to whatever university. This is my son. He's in UCL. This is my son. He's at Cambridge. Hey! I know, true story, I know a man, a born-again believer, and a government minister up to today. Anytime he's going to his hometown, he goes with this motorcade, pumping, miles to his place. He gets down, puts on his clothes. He wears this local cloth, sits with his bodyguard in a taxi and goes. That's whatever he comes back, takes his car and leaves. You may think he's fearful. He knows the altars that are in his hometown. And two members, I'm not sure whether I should say this, went to such places boldly. It took the grace of the Lord for them to come back here alive. Because these family altars, the moment they see you in the night, you are the topic of discussion on that altar. But whoever the Son shall set free shall be free in the name of Jesus. The third thing they do is that they cause limitations and frustrations. They just limit the opportunities that comes your way. And all what they do is that they just frustrate you. And these are caused by river altars. What they do is that they sit on people's breakthrough and they submerge it on the rivers. Somebody from my own family who had married and had become barren. And had the audacity to go to one of these shrines in the Ashanti region called Chiremansu. Then this shrine told this woman the cause of a calamity. That they had literally in the realm of the spirit taken her womb and had buried it under a river in her hometown. So took one of the linguists to go with her. So they got into that city. Oh, Jesus. And this is the witch confessing to me. I had not asked her anything from my own family. Saying this to me. That, we went. But the moment we got off the car and landed in the hometown, we bribed the guy. I said, with money, the moment we got down, we bribed him. So when they got to the river, it was only a formality. Manos you in the name of Jesus. And you know what? Up to today, because of the unseriousness of that lady to serve Christ, up to today, she has no child. River altars. Number four, they deny the program of God in people's life. Understand that for every child of God, God has a purpose and a plan for your life. God had a purpose and a plan for the children of Israel. Through them, all the nations of the earth were to be blessed. God was taking them into the promised land for them to possess the gates of their enemies. God had chosen Israel as his own first son. The moment you come to know Christ, understand that you become the apple of God's eye. And had God not intervened on their behalf in the wilderness, Balaam would have destroyed them through Balak. Is somebody with me? And understand that God has a plan for your life. God has a purpose for your life. But what these altars do is that they sit down and they say all manner of things. Just, you know, at times, you see people who are meant to be very, very intelligent. At times, you see doctors, you see top professionals. And their behavior, you just can't understand. When I was a boy growing up, attending secondary school in the central region back in Africa, Dunkwa, there was a guy, his name was Pakwesi. And Pakwesi and Abe, Pak died very early, but Abe Ku was such that he would drink and drink and drink. And he, anytime he was drunk, he walked wavering. Then he would just say to himself, Abe, I say go straight. And anytime he took his salary, he would just go on the street and start distributing it. And would go and borrow alcohol, apeteshi, VC10, and drink. And so anytime he got his salary, the first thing was for him to pay the seller of the drinks, and then would give his money out. And at times, you are saying to yourself, where are the brains? And it was said that he was one of the best staff at Dunkwa Post Office. But Abe would drank himself till one morning, he could not get up again, died. They denied the program of God in people's life. But manos you in the name of Jesus. The purpose and the plan of God for your life shall surely come to pass. They say that they are wicked spirits. Wicked. And they look at you, the glory of God over your life, and they say, you and your children, you are going nowhere. You are going somewhere in the name of Jesus. Hatred. And they will laugh with you. And when they see you, they say all manner of things to make you think they love you. But in the night, they promise and vow they will never give themselves rest till they cause you and your children to fall. But there is power in the name of Jesus. People who take time to study. To learn hard. The purpose in their heart to do something for themselves in life. Innocent people. Then others just sit down. They've done nothing wrong to them. Nothing wrong. And for some of such people, you've even never spoken with them. Never in your life. But they see the glory of God over your life. And as you march through life, as the children of Israel were marching through the Moabite land, they hide and go to all kinds of altars to destroy your life. But tonight, Jesus, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, shall devour your enemies for you in the name of Jesus. They deny the program of God in people's lives. And some of these people at times, they study and they just abandon their dream and vision in life. And you say, what is wrong with this guy? What is wrong with this guy? Pray for him. Number five, they cause unsolvable mysteries. And doctors will tell you that there are some deaths they can't explain.
It doesn't make sense.
It just doesn't make sense. They can't find the cause. You take such people to the hospital. The moment you get to the hospital, they get well. You bring them home, the sickness starts. All of a sudden, they start growing lame. Naturally, the doctors will conduct tests upon tests. Till when it's too late, they find a name that kind of sickness. They can't explain. All tests. Third world electronics. You see, it is said that every year in every country, millions of children go missing. And the truth is that those who understand altars will tell you that many of such children are offered as sacrifices on altars, minus your children in the name of Jesus. Don't just let your child go anywhere. Don't just let your child sleep anywhere. And it is not everybody who is in the church who is a Christian. Who told you? Who told you? Who? God's word? No. The Bible never said that. The Bible says that it is not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, who shall enter into the kingdom. And in the end, I will separate the sheep from the goats. We are all coming to church. We all dress. We dance. We jump the same. Only God knows what is on the heart of man. But we are not to judge anybody. But we are to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Not being ignorant of the devices of the enemy. Appropriating the authority that has been given unto us. Knowing that there is power in the name of Jesus. And that Jesus is merciful. Had it not been for Christ? Huh? Had it not been for Christ? There are agents of the devil. All what they do is that they are wicked. And when they see you, how they call you? You will sleep. The words out of their mouth alone will make you sleep. They don't love you 1 minute. They don't mean it 1 minute. But God will protect you. I said, God will protect you. Love him. Love God. And hold on close to him. Huh. If I can stand here and preach, there is hope for you. I said, there is hope for you in the name of Jesus. They cause unsolvable mysteries. They also cause a trend of divorce, poverty, barrenness, and untimely death. And many of them, they cause shame. See, understand that the Bible says that the devil comes not except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. I want you to know today that in the name of Jesus, you are victorious. You will not die before your time in the name of Jesus. And one of the biggest tricks of the enemy is to isolate you. And he's very good at that. He will say all manner of things about the place where he knows that the glory of the Lord dwells. Because as long as you are under that corporate anointing, he can't get you. So what he does is to say all manner of things. I tell people that, look, Pastor Kingsley is human and to err is human. I can make mistakes. Me and my leaders, we are people. So we can make mistakes. Isn't it? Oh, yeah. At times, the things that is running through our head. And we may see you and pass by. We don't mean it 1 minute to do that. At times, I'm standing here after the service. I know 7 people are waiting for me upstairs. I know the month has come. There are bills to pay. I know salaries have to be paid. It's enough. Glory to God. No, we don't mean at all to act anyhow. But if for any reason you feel offended, don't just leave the church. Listen, I was in Denmark last week, and a gentleman who follows one of these false, unfortunate prophets, you know, Nigeria is a country where you have the good and you have the bad and you have the ugly. And I believe that if there is a nation in Africa where we have genuine Christians, it's Nigeria. And if there is a nation where we also have crooks, it's Nigeria. Just like America. That one, you can't take it away from our Nigerian brothers. I was invited by Pastor Enoch Adeboye in his camp. 1.2 million people. And when those people lifted their voices, the GO himself is on the floor. What are you talking about? So Nigeria, no matter what happens to Nigeria, Nigeria will stand. Yes. Oh yeah, because there are genuine people in that country lifting an anthem of worship daily unto the Lord. And I was told that prayer is said once every month for 3 days, praying and fasting. Oh gosh. Now, but in that same country, there are some dangerous prophets. And this young boy who was in Pastor Tony's church had left and has started his own church and associates himself with one of these false prophets. Oh, goodness me. And they brought me a woman. She had come because of the ordination, who was a member of Pastor Tony's church. And literally, when I was talking to that woman, the Lord told me that within the next 90 days, she'll be buried. I had it straight in my spirit. Because she was even speaking from her nose. Terminal cancer. And since that young man went, over 5 people have continuously died of the same disease. Because these are churches where they venerate altars. Don't just follow any pastor because you are angry. Don't. Because you are angry. If you are angry with Pastor Kingsley, I want to stand here and let you know that Jesus is the Lord of this church. Amen. I'm telling you. So even when you are angry with me, stay with, let your children stay. Because God is in this house. Amen. And I say this from the bottom of my heart. Don't take them out. Because there are too many wolves out there. Too many of them. It is never God's will that a young woman you enter into marriage, and the young man just turns and start using all manner of bitter words. Seek God. Probably that young man is coming from a place where the altars are working against him. And at times it can be your own home too. Where the altars are such that they don't want you to have a peaceful life with your children. But God will protect you and your children in the mighty name of Jesus. We will start praying very soon. But I want you to know that just as God kept three basic items in the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, three things, the manna in a golden pot was in the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord up to today, and the essence of the manna which when they were taken rotted the next night but was preserved, God wants you to know that he is your source of provision. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Then in that ark also was a rod of Moses. Was a rod. Hallelujah. I've got a preacher here with me. Was a rod of Aaron that budded. And the essence of that rod was to tell who the Lord had given authority to. I want you to know that as a child of God, you have authority in the name of Jesus. Is somebody here with me today? Can I get a witness in the house in the name of Jesus? Then also understand that in that same Ark of the Covenant of the Lord was the stones of the tablets, which was the word of God. All what God wants you to know is that as a covenant child, he's your source and that he will provide. Don't seek any wrong altar for provision. The reason why people go to all these kinds of altars and all kinds, it's some want to be rich quickly. So they go to these altars and they are made to do all manner of things. I remember I was in a city back in Africa called Takoradi, and a young man parked his Mercedes Benz. Young man, but very handsome young man with his hair well cut, took off his clothes and started walking through Takoradi market naked. Then the women started following him. Sakawa, oh, Sakawa, 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 Sakawa. Sakawa. Sakawa is an African word, which means trying to become rich overnight. And apparently, what had been said to this young man, you have to walk naked in the city for 3 days. For what? How much can a man eat? Because there was nothing about the guy that he was mad. Let me share a true story, then we start praying. This one, true story. This one was not a Sakawa story. You know, when J.J. Rawlings overthrew the government, and those were the days when the soldiers were beating people up. And there was a place in Kumasi known as Ashtown. And there were some young boys there known as the Afia boys. They were radicals. Radicals. So the soldiers got to know of these boys and they decided to punish them. So one afternoon, one of them was fast asleep, only in his boxer shorts, in the sister's room. Then the soldiers entered the window, pum, 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 knocking doors. So he got wind, so he jumped through the window, and when he discovered that, just when he was about to jump through and discovered he was only in a boxer short, all what he had was the sister's top cover. The sister's, because he was sleeping on the sister's bed, so wore it with his boxer shorts, and then jumped and then threw the market. So whilst he was running through the market, running for his life, the women were giving way and they were saying, oh, this is very fresh. The madness is just coming. Oh, the Asuna clan. Probably this young man is from the Asuna tribe. Oh, what a young boy. Look, he's not going crazy. And this was him telling his story after the incident. This woman didn't know what, what was after me. Oh, mercy. 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 Because if they had the soldiers got him, that would have been his end. Glory to God. But tonight, I see a people of God. So understand that God wants to be your provider. Don't go to these altars to become rich. They will kill you. They will destroy your life. And some also go there because they want authority. And in the ark of the covenant of the Lord was a rod that budded, Aaron's rod. All what God wanted to do is that I have given you authority. Understand that power belongs to God. And when God gives you power, no man can take it from you. Power. David says, God has spoken once, but it has sounded in my ears two times that power belongs to God. And thirdly, God wants you to know that his word works. He is not a man that he should lie. But tonight, church, I want us to pray some serious prayers. Come on, be on your feet with me. And begin to say this after me. Father, in the name of Jesus, tonight, I surrender to you my spirit, my soul, and my body. I confess that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is my Lord and my Savior. I will serve no other God besides Jesus. Oh Lord, tonight, in the name of Jesus, I boldly confess that from tonight, my life and the life of my family are totally yielded to Christ. From tonight, I boldly confess that I will remove from my heart and from my home anything. Musicians, don't go away. Anything which does not please you. In the name of Jesus, I confess that from tonight, everything that I have has come from you. As I rededicate my life, I also rededicate everything that you have given me unto you. From tonight, I plead the blood of Jesus over my life. From the crowns of my head to the soles of my feet, I boldly declare that I belong to the Lord. Lucifer, tonight, in the name of Jesus, I declare unto you that I am a child of the living God. Any covenant that existed between my ancestors and you, I take myself out in the name of Jesus. The blood of Jesus has cleansed me and has redeemed me from your bondage. All altars in my family that spoke on my behalf tonight, in the name of Jesus, I take myself out of that altar. Any words that were spoken on my behalf on that altar will not work over my life and my children and my future and my business, in the name of Jesus. Tonight, by the word of the living God, I boldly declare that my children are for a sign and for a wonder. From tonight, I plead the blood of Jesus over their lives. I boldly declare that they are covered by the blood. No altar shall work against them in the name of Jesus. Tonight, in the name of Jesus, evil altars in my family, hear me tonight. In the name of Jesus, I send thunder unto that altar, and I destroy every word and every work, anything associated with me that has been taken, any cloth of mine that has been taken and sent to an altar. In the name of Jesus, I cancel its effect. Any photograph of mine that has been taken and sent to an altar, I cancel its effect in the name of Jesus. From tonight, any evil and jealous eyes that have beheld me, I cancel its effect in the name of Jesus. And I boldly declare that from tonight, I am free. I am set free. I am set free. No altar shall work against me, but I stand on the altar of the living God, where the blood of Jesus is the seal of that covenant. And from tonight, I am covered. I'm covered. I'm covered. I'm covered. I'm covered. Come on, give the Lord a clap.